Helping students and healthcare professionals not just survive, but thrive with a purpose. This is the CMDA Student Pulse Podcast with your host, Bill Reichart, National Director of CMDA Campus Ministries.
Well, welcome to another episode of CMDA's Student Pulse Podcast. I'm Bill Reichart, National Director of CMDA's Campus and Community Ministries, and I'm here with Elise Barberis. Elise, welcome.
Thank you so much. I'm glad to be here.
Well, Elise, before we dive in, just give our listeners and viewers a little bit of a bio. You are a student leader with CMDA, and you're at the University of Pittsburgh. You're a rising M2, and we're going to talk a little bit about your story and just the circuitous route that God takes us. And by the way, he takes all of us in these ways in his own way. I can testify as I was reading your story of the ways that he's been at work into your life and brought you to the place that you are at now. And so I think, you know, one of the ways that we try to encourage our listening and viewing audience is to share stories like this so that people can see that God is still in control. He's still ruling and reigning on high, and he's a good and gracious God, and he has been that for you as well. And so let's get started a little bit about your journey and talk about medicine. I'm going to start there. You, very early on, I think, and felt called to be a doctor until you weren't. Explain a little bit of the beginnings of this rumbling of thinking, well, maybe medicine is the call for me, and then why didn't it become just that?
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, you're absolutely right in that when I was a younger person, mm-hmm. I thought without question this was what I was supposed to do and where I was supposed to go, almost maybe like exceeding beyond what was healthy or what was normal. I can't recall the exact moment that I really thought that like medicine was for me. It may have just honestly been learning more about the human body as a young person. I was like 10 years old, and I've always been the sort of person that when I find something that I get really excited about, maybe I latch on even a little bit too hard. That's something that I've worked on moderating as I've gotten older and kind of recognizing that tendency. But I mean, I was a kid that even as early as middle school, if there was a social studies project, let's say, you know, Civil War, we had to do some project on the Civil War. Well, I would do Civil War medicine or World War II medicine. I mean, every opportunity that I had that I could link things back to this focus and this interest on medicine. And so it came as no surprise when I, you know, started college and I was going biochem, biophys, pre-med track. This was the only thing in a lot of ways that mattered to me at that time. And again, I don't think that it was in a healthy way. Mm-hmm.
I was going to ask you, well, maybe I don't want to jump ahead, but what soured you? I mean, you felt like this was it. You had poured yourself into it, but obviously you got soured on the idea that this would be the call for you. Why was that?
Yeah, I think soured is a good word. I think spooked also could be a really good word. I got frightened, mostly surrounding the experience that I got really early on in my pre-medical experience. I was after my freshman year of college, and I got the opportunity to work as a scribe in an emergency department in rural Virginia. And I mean, just to set the stage, this was, I want to say 2012, 2013. And so it was a challenging time for this specific region regarding opioid use, and there was a lot of challenges with just kind of under-resourced departments, I would say, throughout the entire hospital, and certainly the emergency department was no exception. And I think that because of that and a lot of other factors, I met some very happy doctors that really loved the work that they did, and I also met a lot of really unhappy doctors that, you know, essentially said, if you can do anything else with your life and be happy, do that. And it led to me recognizing that I hadn't ever explored anything else other than medicine. I mean, I set my sights at 10 years old and I had not veered. Every extracurricular that I did was somehow related tangentially to medicine. And I just recognized, I think even at that point, and now I really see God's hand in it. At the time, you know, my faith was very much still developing or not even really particularly formed. But God was being so good to me in recognizing that, you know, if I had continued on that path, I really don't think that I would have had the skills that I needed to really longitudinally be happy and to make it through an entire career in this space doing the sort of work that I really feel called to do.
Yeah. So it's the doctors themselves that are, in effect, talking you out of it. They're saying, don't do this, which, I mean, that's alarming. But they were dealing with some unique situations, the burnout and so forth, and they were just wanting you to walk it. Certainly, they wanted your eyes to be wide open, make sure that there was no illusion that this is going to be a very challenging time. So I think it's safe to say for an individual who decides, well, maybe medicine isn't the exact calling for me, then the natural next step would be to go into acting, wouldn't it?
Of course, naturally. Of course. So that is, of course, where my journey took me. Right. I ended up working, well, first I got my PFA, so a pre-professional degree in acting and performance, and then worked as a professional actor for about 5 years. Mm. And yeah, I don't think that anyone would realistically think, oh, medicine to acting, that makes sense. And in reality, it was kind of a slow and gentle transition. It started, I think, in a lot of ways, God just put this interest into my heart. I'd never performed before. I never had the opportunity to audition for a play. And really, when I look back on it, the fact that I was cast the first time that I auditioned when I had no idea what I was doing. I was literally like Googling, like, what is a monologue? and you know, trying to put this together and flying by the seat of my pants. But what God was doing at that time was really remarkable. And I mean, really, it took years for me to really understand where all of these pieces were ultimately fall into place.
Stay with us. More Student Pulse podcast in just a moment.
Having an avenue by which you can serve your hands, the skills that you have for Jesus is awesome. And CMDA has so many opportunities.
I gained a lot of ideas and experiences through CMDA, even to this current day, starting street medicine, starting a free clinic at my church, doing global health missions.
I think there's something in our hearts that comes alive. We are stretched outside our comfort zone and have an opportunity to serve others.
Yeah, let's touch on that a little bit, because you said this and we were communicating via email. Good acting requires honest presence, authentic listening, and a willingness to relate to others in a non-judgmental fashion, even when they think and act differently than you. These skills, it turns out, are really crucial for medicine, too. How did you discover that? And how has those skills helped you in this journey towards medicine?
Yeah, absolutely. So when you are acting and when you are taking on a character that thinks and has different life experiences than you do, you need to be able to look at the choices that they make leading up to the scene that you're in the scene itself, and then also, you know, think through the choices that you believe they would make afterwards. And a lot of times those choices are really different than the choices that you would make as a person. So for me, what that meant is I really had to push and I really had to broaden my perspectives and also I think my tolerance and my understanding of other people, and understanding that at the end of the day, all of us are walking around. We are the main character in our stories. I mean, ultimately, the main character should, of course, be Jesus. But as we walk around, we're focused on our actions. We're not focused as much on the actions as others. And generally, the choices that we make are the choices that we think are the right choice, the good choice. We're all a protagonist in our story. Very few people, I certainly hope, are walking around thinking, oh, I'm you know, the antagonist in my story. And so coming to appreciate that sometimes people are going to make choices that you are not going to understand and that you won't necessarily agree with, but making the choice to acknowledge that from their perspective, this is the loving, right, good choice, and then respond to that with love and kindness and to try and understand it. You know, those are all skills that I built up, ironically, in rehearsals and in scene study. Mm. And now when I get, you know, the real privilege and blessing of working with patients, I think it's a lot easier for me sometimes to remember, wow, this is my everyday going into the hospital, but this may be the worst day of this person's life. Mm. This person is afraid. This person is uncomfortable. This person is hurting. And all of those things are going to lead to them acting in ways that they may not act in a different setting. But the reality is, I don't know how I would act in this position. Yeah. And what I know my job is to give love and respect and understanding and to show up in the best way that I possibly can.
Mm, that's a good word. It sounds like it's really shaped and formed your ability to have a empathy and be present with that person sitting across from you and to have that authentic listening. And those are all such valuable skills for a healthcare professional to have. And so, but you're in acting. You're trying to audition for roles and trying to develop that career. So what happened to kind of give you, it's going to feel like whiplash, right? You were thinking about being a doctor, now you're an actor. Well, now you're going back into medicine. I want you to touch on what were the circumstances that got impressed upon you, but also I don't want to leave out another component that's going on at the same time is your faith. Tell me, God, what was God doing in your own faith while you were in Atlanta?
Yeah, absolutely. So those years that I was acting as a professional actor down in Atlanta were formative on so many different levels. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, to start with that faith component, I'm from Oregon, so this was my first time living, you know, thousands of miles away from my family and everybody that I knew. And that experience really forces you to get to know yourself in ways that sometimes it's easy to kind of not when you have a family telling you who you are, because, you know, this is the person you've been in this family structure as long as you've lived there. And so in Atlanta, I actually got the opportunity to go to my uncle's friend's church service. And I was raised in a Catholic home. I kind of stepped away from organized faith. My whole family really had as I got into my teenage years. And so this was my first time back in a church service for a while. And it was expository preaching. I didn't have the words to describe that at the time. I'd never experienced anything like that. But it was my first time really at a church that was taking the time to break down the Bible, like word by word, verse by verse. And I didn't know what happened or what was happening, but I just started crying quietly. I didn't make a scene, but I just felt tears streaming down my face and I mean, truly, bless my uncle, who's this man of incredible deep faith and a role model to me on so many different levels. But he clocked it. He saw. He waited until the service was over, and then afterwards, he asked me, "Okay, well, what was going on? What did you feel?" And he just very simply said, "Well, looks like it's time for you to find a church." So I did. I found a church community, and you know, I started developing this personal relationship with God that I didn't even know I was missing. And, you know, this was a hard time. This was, I was pretty new to Atlanta, like still getting to know the community during COVID. And so suddenly I was isolated. I really didn't have people. I wasn't close enough to be in anybody's bubble, so to speak. And I found myself in this space where I had a lot of time to start to get to know God. And I think that, you know, so much of those experiences ended up being really crucial for what came next, which was I was working for a company that worked with all different sorts of corporations to help them with like empathy and soft skills. And so it was interesting because I was getting to use these acting skills, but in a more technical and organized form, and really helping people have harder and harder conversations. And when this company found out that because of my science background, I wasn't super afraid of medical jargon, they ended up actually having me become more and more involved in some of the palliative health conversations and some of the really challenging health care-based conversations that they worked on with their trainees. So I ended up actually designing trainings to help people have hard conversations in a healthcare setting. Mm. So this whole, again, God is so cool and so incredible in the way that he works, but essentially he managed to very gently, well, I guess to begin, not so gently, like very aggressively send me away from medicine. And then very gently, once I built up these really necessary skills, to bring me right back. Mm. And there was one particular day, I remember I was sitting and I was running through a training with a resident. And I realized that I really would have preferred to be the resident and to be having this conversation in real life, as opposed to training someone how to have that conversation. And so I felt that. I immediately pushed it out of my head. I was at a very stable place in my career. My acting career was also beginning to really grow and develop. And I felt the last thing that I needed to do was just, you know, throw this all into disarray. And God kept pushing and I kept pushing back. And I mean, really, I fought him for a long while. And I was angry. I was angry that I was kind of being asked to go back after I kind of had this weird crisis of identity when I left the whole right. Pre-medical thing. And honestly, finally, I just leveled with him. Mm-hmm. And I said, okay, I hear you. I feel what I think you're asking me to do. Mm-hmm. And I am scared out of my mind. Mm-hmm. If this is something that I am being called to do, I know that I need to lean on you. But what I need you to know, and you know this because you made me, but I'm going to be a flight risk because the minute that I have the opportunity to go back to what is safe, I'm going to take it. So I am going to need you to close some doors related to the path that I'm currently on. And I am going to need you to open some doors into this path that it really seems you want me to be on. And I'm going to do my best to follow you. Mm. But I'm pretty freaked out about that prospect. Mm. And I mean, he is so. And he's so good because when I say that he knew those doors off of the hinges, and he has just kept doing that ever since I started this journey in ways I don't deserve. I mean, just truly, I don't. And it has been the biggest privilege of my life to be able to see all of these different puzzle pieces fit together. Mm. And, you know, the beautiful thing is, not only has he been good and faithful during this medical journey, he was preparing me for years.
That's such a good word to remember, even when we may be in a different place and the acting, like you said, was God was blessing it. You were developing your career, but it was a moment of preparation, really, for the next thing that God had in store. And we don't want to inappropriately give the indication that, you know, getting to medical school, getting here, was a seamless, effortless process. It required a lot of work. I know you had to get prereqs. There was a lot of things that got you to this place. But to your point is that God was faithful, constantly walking alongside you, directing you, closing those doors, blowing the doors wide open, getting you obviously at Pitt now, which I'm so excited for what God is doing there. And so now you're at Pitt. You're beginning this career. And again, you got many more years ahead. There's I mean, there's a lot of things that God's going to continue to do in and through this journey. But in the moment that you're there, you realize that it's important to connect with Christians early on. So you get connected with a Christian fellowship. Talk a little bit about what you experienced early on. And obviously, you were trusting God to do yet still more within that fellowship that you had found at Pitt. So you'd gone there. It was a fairly small, modest group of individuals, right, that were gathering?
Yeah, absolutely. So there are a lot of spaces that I thought I might be able to grow into and to potentially, you know, lead in some capacity in medical school. And I'll be really honest, I didn't think that a Christian fellowship was going to be that space. Okay. Not because, you know, God and you know, his work are not central to everything that I do and you know, not the thing that I focus on as my number one, but just because I didn't think that I had the maturity or frankly, you know, some of the life experiences to be able to really contribute and help as a leader in this space. So when I started coming to our Christian fellowship, what needs to be really clear is that the foundational work was actually done by a number of students who are a year ahead of me. I think at one point there was a CMDA chapter, there was some sort of Bible study that existed, and my understanding is that it kind of just fell apart during COVID, unfortunately. And so the class prior to me, there were about four students that did an incredible job of bringing a Bible study and again, just kind of bringing that Christian presence back to our campus. But you're right, it was small. Our dental school right across the way had a really lovely and flourishing CMDA chapter. But for us, it kind of wasn't there. And so I started coming to the weekly Bible studies. And unfortunately, I was kind of the only first year that was consistently coming. Mm-hmm. And so two of my, at the time, second year, so a year ahead of me, friends and I, we ended up meeting we met just about every day over our winter break. And we kind of did our own silent devotional. And when we were doing the silent devotional, we would always end with prayer. And every single day we prayed that we would just see our little fellowship grow and develop and flourish, and that, you know, other students who knew Jesus or were seeking him would find us as a space. I don't know what to say other than God is good and God did this, because the first week back, by no actions of our own, we had like 17 people show up to our Bible study. Yeah. And it just has continued to grow and develop. And now we have a new medical school that's opening up in Pittsburgh. And there's talk about, okay, how can we support each other? And there are suddenly all of these opportunities for, you know, Christian healthcare trainees to support each other. And it is this beautiful thing that I get to play some small part in, you know, co-leading this Bible study, but really it's him. God is doing this, and we're just holding on.
That's a lot of the Christian life, is God's moving this train forward, and you're just trying to hold on. That's right.
Stay with us. More Student Pulse podcast in just a moment.
What happens after you finish those academic years and get into your clinical years and you realize that the physical healing that you're providing is really only temporary? You know, the first time that I sat down and I actually offered to pray with a patient, and amazingly they said yes, when I actually sat down to pray with them, I didn't know what to say. And I was kind of scared to begin with, because I thought I needed some lofty words to reach to heaven, when in all actuality, that patient just really needed me to sit with him and to hold his hand and to really just bring his needs before the great physician. Prayer is a therapeutic intervention, And it is just as important as that prescription that you write, the referral to surgery, or any therapy that you send a patient to.
Well, God was going before you, certainly, and working in the ways that you describe, but working in and through you because you're willing and faithful to be used by Him and working on you. You know, these are transformative times. I'm sure it's just increased and strengthened your faith as you continually watch Him show up in these ways. So that's an exciting testimony. But let me move a little fast forward. Just until recently, you went to the National Convention. It was in Nashville, and that's where my executive assistant had a chance to meet you and hear your story and then made the introduction for you to be on this podcast. How did that National Convention, talk a little bit about your experience with that, because a lot of times we find that that is a real eye-opener for students. They realize, boy, this community is much bigger than just our fellowship. And did you notice that? If you did, how has that impacted your faith?
Absolutely. I will be honest, going to the National Convention, there was one girl from the dental school who ended up coming, but there weren't going to be any other medical students from Pitt because unfortunately it just didn't work out with their schedules. Mm-hmm. I was pretty anxious. You know, I think that I was going into it with a level of apprehension that, you know, unfortunately us humans like to do. You know, I was playing the comparison game of, you know, what are other folks going to be able to bring in terms of their experiences with CMDA and what am I going to have to offer? I mean, am I, again, kind of like one of those, am I even supposed to be in this space? I know that that sounds so silly, but you know, the imposter syndrome is real. And when I say that it was some of the best, you know, couple days of my life, and that it was really, really sad to leave, and it's really, really hard to have to wait for the next one. And you know, I guess the only way that I can describe it is that I never knew what it would be like to be surrounded by so many people who had this incredible faith and who had this, you know, incredible focus on serving God and doing that for so many people through healthcare. And to just be exposed to that and surrounded by that and to meet people who were at the same place that I am and ahead of me in terms of training, to meet people who are doing the work, whether it be on the mission field abroad, whether it be, you know, locally with their own communities. It opens my eyes up and into the very, very many ways that I can integrate my faith into the work that I do each and every day. And it was so funny because I was talking to some of my my friends in Bible study afterwards, and I was just like, my heart is breaking that I can't be there anymore because it's the only time in my life that I've had the opportunity to you know, talk about medicine, talk about healthcare, talk about faith, you know, like integration into that, and then pray, and then go and talk about healthcare some more, and then pray, and then go and talk about healthcare some more, and then pray. And I was like, it was the most just encouraging, affirming, best experience that I've had in a really long time. And I mean, I still talk to students at other schools. I feel like we are all, you know, putting our heads together, figuring out, okay, well, what's working really well, like at Mayo, for example, that we can integrate here at Pitt, or, oh, here's this really cool thing that we're doing at Pitt. I would love to tell you about it and see if it would, you know, be helpful in your program. And, you know, that's what it's all about. Like, that is what fellowship is all about. And so to have that opportunity, especially this early on in my training, and especially when, like I said, I had a level of hesitance wondering, like, oh, you know, here we are from this like humble, tiny little chapter. Should I be here? And all that I, you know, want to say is I want to encourage every single student who has the opportunity to go as soon as you possibly can, because it really was just the most incredible couple days. And there has not been a day that's gone by since I haven't thought about, you know, some of the lessons that I learned there and integrated them into the work that I do here on campus.
Mm. Wow. It's a powerful, powerful testimony. And I would echo your admonition and your encouragement to consider going. It is something that we take very seriously to try to get students there. We try to underwrite the costs when possible, trying to make sure that there's very few roadblocks that can stand in the way. And it's been fun to see students engaging more and more every year with our national convention. And I think that cross generational interaction is so valuable. And it gets you exposed to people who have walked the journey, you know, the good, the bad, and the ugly, but walked the journey of living out one's faith within healthcare. And it's an incredible, incredible time. And well, as we kind of wrap up our conversation, maybe speak to the audience, students who might find themselves maybe a little lost or maybe a little wondering what God's doing in their life. We know that, you know, this is a very, it can be a very challenging season going through training, obviously. A lot of stressors, a lot of maybe even some doubts and so forth. Having gone through what God has been teaching you these many years, this circuitous route, as we called it early, what would you say to your fellow students? How would you encourage them if they're going through a season like that? What would you say to them that would encourage and lift them up?
I think that the biggest thing that I have taken away from my experiences is that through the good, the bad, the ugly, we can rely on him and we can trust him and we can trust that his vision for us is in many cases so much bigger than we could have ever believed. And I mean, I'll be honest, it's been really humbling. There have been times where I've been brought to my knees through this journey, questioning what he was doing and what was in store. And, you know, when I look back at those times, those were the times where I feel like I had grown the most in my faith, in my relationship with him, and where I have had the incredible blessing and opportunity to grow. You know, I have had, like you said, a pretty like circuitous, strange path to get here. And I know that I will continue to have times where I think exactly, you know, where I am supposed to land is X. And the next thing I know, I find myself Y. And if there's one thing that this journey has taught me, is that we can trust him. We can trust him that we're going to end up where we are supposed to be. And that sometimes that journey is not going to be direct and it's not going to be what we expect. But if you continue to really try and follow his plan and his path rather than your own, you will be amazed by the ways that he is able to work to not only put you exactly where you are supposed to be, but with the skills and, you know, the life experiences that you didn't even know you needed.
Yeah. Good word. Great way to end and put a conclusion to our time together. This has been a treat. And I suspect God has got some incredible things ahead for you. Residency yet to be determined. Where do you think you, medicine-wise, do you have any particular leanings as to what kind of specialty you'll engage with? Or is that too soon to say?
You know, it's funny you ask. If there's one thing that my path has taught me, it's that I need to be open to him. And so I understand that, you know, whatever I say now is not set in stone.
We're not going to hold you to it. We're not going to hold you to it.
Okay, deal. But I feel really called and really moved to work with really sick kids. And right now, I wonder if that might be in a palliative care space.
Okay.
And I'm, you know, kind of particularly excited in this intersection between genetics and pediatric palliative care. So really working with those kiddos who get diagnosed with a congenital congenital illness that, you know, maybe today we don't really have any sort of treatment interventions to help them get better. And it's funny because, again, I think I always felt intrigued and interested in palliative care, specifically with the pediatric population. But, you know, the minute that you tell that to anybody, they say, oh, man, no, don't do that. That sounds so sad. And that sounds so hard. And again, I don't think that I would have had the skills to be able to really consider that space had I gone the route that I thought that I was going to go very directly as a young person. But the skills that I have as a little bit older of a medical student, and of course, I will continue to be older as I go through all of the training. I really think that that might be a space that I'm supposed to be in. And, you know, the experiences that I have had in that space already, being present for, you know, the death of children and to be with families afterwards and during that process. When I say it is a hard space, but it is the most sacred space, on the side of heaven. We'll see. We'll see. But I'm really excited to see where he directs me.
Amen. Well, Elise, thank you again for this conversation. And we're going to put some information in the show notes about National Convention. We've talked about it. Not too early to think and consider. And hopefully those listening or watching will join us next year. It's going to be near St. Louis in St. Charles, Missouri. So looking forward to that. Again, thanks for sharing some time. I'm excited about the journey God has you on, and look forward to continuing to see you in future national conventions and seeing the ways that God is working in and through your life. So thank you, Elise.
Thank you so much for having me, and I cannot wait to see you at the next national convention.
All right.
Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time. CMDA's Student Pulse podcast is a production of the Christian Medical and Dental Associations. The opinions expressed by guests on this podcast are not necessarily endorsed by the organization. CMDA is non-partisan and does not endorse political parties or candidates for public office. The views expressed on Student Pulse podcast reflect judgments regarding principles and values held by CMDA and its members.